thing is what you call yourself in the world. So call yourself that new name. As the Lord has called you every day, you are new in Christ every day. So that name you give yourself before speaking to anybody. That's why when you wake up in the morning, don't rush to the loo. Go to your bedside. On your nail, say something about your destiny. Before you open your mouth, whatever or how scary the dream of yesterday might be, the vision that the Lord has for you is still the best. To be honest, yesterday's dream might be very scary, but the vision of Christ for your tomorrow is able to destroy that scary movie you just released. It was a movie. It wasn't real, to be honest. Nollywood me. Don't, so I'm saying this so that you don't rely on it. It might be scary. No, it wasn't real. Say, oh, it's not even me. And your own destiny shall be different by the grace of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. What's today's message, brethren?
My Garden of Eden.
Are we all there?
Yes, sir.
My Garden of Eden. Don't forget, just to remind you, the summary of the message is in the pamphlet you are holding. On your way home, you are allowed to read it. The only time you're not allowed to read it for health and safety reasons is when you're on your bike. So don't read it when you are riding a bike. But if you're on the train, you are on the bus, read it. And that will summarize what you just heard. Also, prayer points are there for the week. Please open it, declare those prayer points. God has used one of us to say this is what God wants us to put at that corner, because that corner used to be empty. While we were waiting, if you noticed, it used to be an empty corner. So God spoke to somebody to tell us what we must put in that corner. And it has been working for people who use it. Keep using it. Those words of prayer are powerful. Pronounce them onto your destiny, onto the destinies of people around you, and you will see, experience positive changes. So today's message shall explain through the Spirit of God what Garden of Eden means. And it will also show us God's intention of putting man in the Garden of Eden. Also, the content of Garden of Eden shall be explored. We shall be looking at the content of Garden of Eden. We shall also be looking at the hidden plans of the evil concerning your Garden of Eden. My Garden of Eden. Also, finally, through the Spirit of God, the Almighty, we shall look at how we can survive and succeed in our garden without compromising godly principles. Everyone has got their own Garden of Eden. Remind somebody, tell them you've got your own Garden of Eden. So every Christian must endeavor and they must ensure they are in their Garden of Eden in order for them to be able to display to maximum what God has called it. I realize, and from findings, majority of Christians today are struggling because they are operating outside Eden. They are operating outside the covenant of Eden. And majority of Christians, they have been chased out of their own Eden. And that is why they are labored brethren. They will labor a lot. They are not honored worshippers. Many have been chased out of their own Eden. What am I saying? Majority of Christians, they are operating outside the arena of Christ in their life. And they are camping outside Christ's coverage. And that is why they have poor signal. And that is why they have network failure to sources. Because where they are gathered is away from Christ's covenant. Let's get it clear. So if you are here, you are married, congratulations. As long as your marriage is founded on the rock, as long as your marriage is under the instruction and guidance of Holy Spirit, that is your own Garden of Eden. If you are here, you are employed, well done. As long as that job has been given to you through the guidance and illustration of Christ Jesus, that is your own Garden of Eden. The church you are presently attending, the one you are a member to, as long as it's God who has pointed that church to you for you to be there, that is your own Garden of Eden. In fact, the country you are at moment may be your own Garden of Eden. That country you find yourself will be your own Garden of Eden. And if you are here, you are in godly approved relationship. That is your own Garden of Eden. So what is this Garden of Eden we are talking about? What is Garden of Eden? So your Garden of Eden is where God has placed and positioned you for him to be able to fellowship with you. I'll put it again. Your Garden of Eden is where Christ has put you, where God has positioned you for him to be able to fellowship with you. So if God has put you in a marriage, that is your Garden of Eden. If God has placed you at a job that is very good and lucrative for you, that is your own Garden of Eden. If you are in a relationship, that is your own Garden of Eden. Wherever he puts you and allows him to fellowship with you, that is your Garden of Eden at that point in time. So, your Garden of Eden is a land rich in godly pronouncement. It's a land rich in godly pronouncement of various blessings. And this is where the promises and pronouncement of God take place. Your Garden of Eden is where God promises, God pronouncement take place. Genesis 1:28 confirmed that. And God blessed them. Genesis 1:28. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. So your Garden of Eden is where godly promises and pronouncement are at higher level in your life. So wherever you find yourself, and you are enjoying those maximum blessings, you are enjoying those maximum pronouncements from above, that is your own Garden of Eden. Are we together?
Yes,
sir. So, brethren, your Garden of Eden is where God puts you at every point in time, where you can be located. Whenever God wants to see you, he knows where he puts you. He knows that job place. He knows that marriage. He knows that house. He knows that relationship. He knows that friendship you are. He can pick you for whatever he wants to do gloriously to your destiny. Genesis 2:9. And out of the ground made the Lord. Genesis 2:9. And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to what? To the sight. And good for food. So from here, this is what this means. It means your Garden of Eden is the address that God puts you for him to be able to address, to redress you in accordance to his riches in glory. Are we together?
Yes.
Sorry, it's too much of grammar, but yes. I will break it up in the future.
Yes.
Garden of Eden is that address that the Lord has put you for him to be able to address you, for him to be able to redress you in accordance to his glory. So the soil of Garden of Eden is very rich. The soil of that marriage which the Lord has put you is very rich. The soil of that job which God has given to you because you pray hard for it, that soil is very rich. The soil of that relationship where God, that God has given to you, is very rich. The soil of that church that the Lord has placed your feet because God has chosen that to be your garden is very rich. That soil is very rich in blessing. And so the outcome or the product you get when you are in your Garden of Eden is always very pleasant to sight. And it's always very pleasure to the Savior. What did I say? As long as you are where God wants you to be, whatever you do at that point in time flourishes. Simple. As long as you are in your Garden of Eden that the Lord has placed you, whatever you touch become glorious. Genesis 2:8. And the Lord God planted a garden eastern in Eden. Genesis 2:8. Are we there?
Yes.
And the Lord God planted a garden eastern in Eden. And there he put the man whom he had formed. I want you to note those two words. They are planted. And number one is eastern. Eastern word. This one says eastward in Eden. East. East. Does that sound familiar? The wise man from
east.
Does it sound familiar?
Yes, sir.
I remember when we were in university, we would usually crack this joke. Somebody was saying, no, every name, I think we had Emmanuel. And he says, Emmanuel, Benjamin, those names are always in the Bible. And the other one said, well, forget about names. My tribe is always mentioned, has always been mentioned in the Bible. And the one said, oh, which one are you from? Said, I'm from Ibulan. He said, and so what? So what do you think the Bible meant when he said the Eastern people came to see Jesus? Are they not the Igbo people? Read your Bible very well. Eastern people, Igbo people. Igbo people. So note those words. Eastward in Eden. Eastward. And planted. So it means your Garden of Eden is wherever God plants you. Wherever God plants you. Plant. And when he plants you, he plants you for direct contact with the sun. And that is why he mentioned that east. Sun rises from east. And who is the sun? Jesus. 84:11. Psalm 84:11. You will get there. God will always plant you where he can always have direct link with you. The Bible says he planted a garden at the east ward in Eden. Now we are analyzing that east, where the sun comes from. Who is the sun? Psalm 84:11. God is the sun and the sheep. So that you being the light, according to the book of Matthew 5:14, whenever you are being positioned where God wants you to be, you'll be able to shine. Are we together? So God does not just put anybody anywhere. He knows his own location to where you are. Are we together? So if you find yourself somewhere, be rest assured that God is nearby. The Bible says he planted a garden at the east ward of Eden, east where the sun comes from. And God is that same sun, Psalm 84:11. And you are the light. So when you are close to the sun, you shine better. So wherever God has put you, you'll be able to shine most. And that is why, brethren, the message is sought to sensitize you why you must be where God wants you to be. Your Garden of Eden. So I can boldly say your Garden of Eden is a position where godly plans are accessible, reachable, and achievable. It is a purposely built place where God put you for him to continuously water you as well. God waters every destiny. Let's confirm that. Genesis chapter 2 verse 10. God waters destiny. So wherever he puts you, there is a springs of water nearby. Because your destiny must not go dry. Amen. Are we together?
Yes.
Genesis chapter 2 verse 10. And a river went out of Eden to water the garden. And from thence it was parted and became into four heads. So, brethren, this connotes that the whole four corners of the whole world, your destiny shall be known.
Amen.
And it shall make impact.
Amen.
As long as God has put you in that Eden. Note those important points. Son, when he put you, God is always nearby. He says he planted the garden eastward of Eden. And he waters them. He waters that garden. You are that garden that the Lord waters. So wherever he puts you, as long as God has planted you there, he waters you. You are not going to go dry.
Amen.
The environment may be dry. The news around may be dry. But the God who has positioned you waters you on daily basis.
Amen.
And that is the pronouncement you need as a Christian. When the whole world goes dry, say, I am watered on daily basis. Say to somebody, I'm water and fed. Because you know the bread of life. What else do you need? Christ is the bread of life. And it's nearby. It waters you. It feeds you. And that is why you fear not. As long as he has put you in that marriage, he will water you.
Amen.
As long as he has put you in that job setting, the Lord will water you.
Amen.
If it's truly he has given you that relationship will not go dry.
Amen.
Amen.
Say to somebody, I'm waking up now.
I'm waking up.
So once you are in your Garden of Eden, this is what it means. Note it. Once you are in your Garden of Eden, it means your life brings lives unto others. You don't agree? When you are where God wants you to be, your life will begin to bring life, joy unto other people. So your presence put others at their positive position of godly production. Your presence. You help and partner with Lord created work to function according to their call. So briefly, let's discuss some facts about Garden of Eden. There are many facts about Garden of Eden, but let's pick two important facts about Garden of Eden that every Christian must always associate with. They mustn't miss it. Number one, in the Garden of Eden, there is command for every creature. There is instruction for every action from the mouth of God. Genesis chapter 2 verse 16. Genesis 2 verse 16. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of garden thou may freely eat. Verse 17. But of the tree of good, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, verse 17 now, thou shalt not eat of it. Are we together? For in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. The interpretation is very simple. There are rules and laws to every Garden of Eden. Every Garden of Eden you may find yourself, there are rules and laws. Don't forget, no rule without the ruler. No ruler without a rule. You are born to rule. So you must learn to live by rule. Every Christian is born to rule. You are born to lead. So you must be able to condition yourself to be able to be obedient to every rule. We are looking at facts in the Garden of Eden. Those facts that every Christian must not miss. Because it determines their survival, their success in the Garden of Eden they may find themselves. Every destiny and destiny position has protocols that must be obeyed and followed before the blessing of the land can follow them. Every garden you find yourself, a student in a school, that is your Garden of Eden at that point in time. There are laws that govern that school, that authority at that point in time, which must be followed. Organization and orientation of your Garden of Eden, how well it will be organized, how beautiful it will look like, determine how much submission you have for the rules that guide such garden. I'll break it. How well you are able to do in your marriage, how well you are able to do in school, how well you are able to do at your job setting, are being determined by how much you are ready to put yourself under submission of the rules that bring success to that setting. If they say receive 8 o'clock and you come 8:20, you are bringing the company down in a way. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Know this. Heavenly law, those laws, don't forget, don't think far, we are looking at the Garden of Eden. Important factors that they must not miss. The commands are there. Every system must go by the law for them to succeed. So heavenly law, the law that the Lord has built in heaven, those heavenly laws, they humble and prepare you for heavenly honors. They The law that the Lord has prepared above, those laws are preparing you for God to honor you. Godly laws remind you of your position as a man. You'll be wondering, when God created that beautiful Garden of Eden, why must he put a law? Why must he put an exception? Why must he put an instruction again? He could have allowed Adam and Eve to enjoy everything to maximum. But note this, wherever you find yourself, those laws around you remind you of your position as a man. So it makes you conscious of the fact that you have superiority in God. It makes you remember that I'm a man. There's somebody who is the maker of man. So the law God gave Adam and Eve was not a punishment. It was not a punishment, it was not a pressure, but it was a measure to make them a man, why God remains the maker of man. You may need to listen to this message again to break it down. Forget it. When God gives you a law, an instruction in a marriage, it's not because God wants that man to enslave you. It's not because God wants that woman to bring you under ungodly submission. It's for the two of you to be under measure of God so that that marriage can bring pleasure to God. So, whoever wants to make God pleased with them, if you want God to be pleased with you in your Garden of Eden, you must be obedient. You must be obedient to the rules of God that governs the life in that garden. We are all in different gardens. If you want to succeed in the garden of matrimony, there are rules. If you want to succeed in the garden of academics, the youth, there are rules. Phone away while you study. I've said it before. If you want your face to last longer on Facebook, you need to face your book first. Otherwise, you get face out. People will not even read about you any longer. If you want to live longer in any relationship, there are laws that bind you. And the law in the Garden of Eden was just a reminder that God is always God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So marriage has its own rules in Colossians chapter 3, verse 18 to 21. Wives, submit yourself unto your own husbands as it fits in the law. Colossians 3, 18 to 21. That is for marriage, that is for family. Husband, love your wives. And be not bitter against them. Are you listening, husband?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Yes. Yes, a woman can be husband. Especially when the husband is sleeping. I am the husband. My husband is sleeping. Verse 20 says, children, obey your parents. Everybody has their beat there. That Colossians 3, verse 18 to 21 should be written out and laminated, mommy, and put at the living room for every family to read. Whenever daddy come home, do like, say, daddy, Colossians 3, 18 to 21.
Love your wife.
Love your wife. And whenever mommy thinks they are in charge of the house, say, mama, you want to read verse 18. Wives, submit. And I like men when they get to that, they say, submit on your knee unto your own husbands. And children, you have your own in verse 20. Obey your parents in all things. To be honest, obey your parents in all things. Why in all things? Because parents have been to all things you have never been to. They have been to the darkest age. They have been to the lightest age. They have the experience to guide you. When they say, don't go out at night, listen to them. They've been there before. I removed my trousers one day, and my son, my daughters, they saw the wound from football, all from here to here. If I open it, you will pick race. Thank you, mommy. If I open my leg, you will pick race. Ah, uncle, were you in the military? Uncle Pastor, did they shoot you? No. It was from fighting, jumping around. My auntie here, my new mommy here knows. jumping from everywhere to everywhere. 4 o'clock a.m., come back home. You will leave 12 midnight when everybody's asleep. Come back 4 a.m., jump. By 5:30, you wake everybody. Let's pray. They say, hey, Omari. They won't know where Omar has been for the last 3-4 hours. Thank God. So children, please listen. Listen to them. Listen to them. They've been there. To employers. And whatever, if you find yourself in the Garden of Eden, you have been employed very well, if God has put you in an employment setting, it says something in Colossians 3:23 here. It says, whatever you do, do it wholeheartedly. As to the Lord. Colossians 3:23. And not unto men. Whatsoever ye do, do it heartedly. As to the Lord and not unto men. Christ wants you, to be honest, to work when you are being employed by the government of this country or by anybody. Work as if it was Christ who employed you. Some of us will work as if, oh, it's not my job. One day you'll be in that position, you will employ somebody. So don't say, oh, it's nobody's job. Everybody's job is nobody's job. Don't say that. Christians don't say that. You work as if Christ is looking at you. Because when he brings the reward, God rewards you. He touches the heart of the kings to reward you. And that is why you will not be there and your manager will be fighting and fighting for you.
Amen.
It is not that manager. It is God who has touched that manager. Look, this one is doing extra work. How many of you get to work and pray for that employment? How many of you remember at your prayer time to pray for that company or that country that feeds you? These are the things God uses. These are the things that stand to support you, to pillar you when you have issue. I've worked in places and the place was about to crumble. No, I think they were about to like leave or something like that. When they were had to leave because of one or two issues. And I put my feet down. Look, I'm not going. I will go if only God wants me to go. I've not only labored here physically, I've labored in this employment setting spiritually. Because I remember I wake up at night and pray hard. I remember I will get to work, I will go to the loo, pray hard. That whatever will happen where I am today will be peace. For the patient, for the staff, for the equipment, everything, whether it concerns me or not. And I will always remember, colleague will always be like, look, wherever Sunday is there, there will be peace. They want me in their setting. So when you work as if you are doing it for Christ. Forget about that money they have paid. God is giving you more. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And if you find yourself in a country setting, as we mentioned, your GE, your Garden of Eden, maybe that country you find yourself, pray for that country. The Bible says in the book of Romans chapter 13 verse 1, say, let every soul be subject unto higher powers. For there is no power but of God. Romans 13 verse 1. The powers that are ordained of God. So if your Garden of Eden is this country, as you are here, I am here, this is our Garden of Eden, let's pray for the upliftment, for the peace of this country. It's your job, it's my job. And these are the things that stand to defend us. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We have mentioned the law aspect of the Garden of Eden. That is number one thing. Number two thing you must know, that every Christian must not close their eyes to in the Garden of Eden, is every garden has its own snake. To be honest, do not be carried away by the beauty and the blessing of your garden. Every garden has its own snake. There is always a snake in every garden. Be careful. Identify them and manage the snake. Who will not allow you to live long in that garden? The snake in your garden are the people and the pressure around you that make you think God alone is not enough. Notice, two important things you must not miss when you are studying that Genesis chapter 2 from 7 to 18. The Garden of Eden, the commandment, they are there for reasons. The snake. Every country has those snakes. Whatever Garden of Eden you find yourself, there is that snake hiding somewhere. Identify them. before they destroy you. These snakes we are talking about, they make you doubt the authority of Christ. Don't forget, a man can be in form of a snake, in characters, in their hatches, in their hordes. These snakes we are talking about, they take you from position of putting God first to position of putting God last. It may be somebody at workplace who all the time always put your name on the Sunday list. I know you will need some money, I put your name down for Sunday. You say, oh, thank you, auntie. The next Sunday, I know you need money, I put your name for Sunday. Thank you, auntie. Next Sunday, for the whole year, you realize your Sunday has been satanically manipulated by somebody. Pray against it. It could be a man, it could be a woman, demonstrating those snake qualities. Snake people, they want to tempt you away from Christ. They do everything to tempt you away from Christ. Somebody gave a testimony here that, look, if you are going to pay me double on Sunday, if you are going to, you know, take away my benefit, don't give it to me. Sunday is my Sunday for Christ. This is what God wants. These snake people, snake-like people, all over the world, in every garden, they want to tempt you away from Christ. Do everything possible. They don't want you to appreciate your God. They are envious people. Know their characteristics today. So if you see people around you demonstrating those qualities, you know they are snakes. It happens in marriage. It could be on Sunday, your husband will just wake up 10:30 when you're supposed to be in the car and say, ah, where's my breakfast? You say, oh, I rebuke this snake material with my marriage. Anybody. They don't want you to understand the word patient. The snake people, they ask you to go when God says, wait. You know, there are times God says, wait. Not every road to your journey in destiny is a straight line. Note it. There are times you get to the bend of life. The speed you started from here is not the same speed. I don't drive, but I stay and live with the woman who drives recklessly. So, the speed. You wonder how I will get home tonight. I get the bus pass in my house. The speed you start here is not the same speed you get here. This is a corner of life. When you don't know the calamities coming around, that is why God will say, wait, take it easy. Not every road is straight. Brethren, when you are with snakes in life and destiny, they want you to go. They don't want you to understand the word wait. Take it easy. They cannot see ahead the corners of life. That is when God wants you to wait, because God can see the dangers ahead. The dangers coming. The snake people are too desperate for success. When you see them, identify them. Those are the qualities of snake people around you. When you see a friend who's like, whether they like it or not, I must succeed. You should be careful. You may be the next victim he's going to use for money. To be honest, you don't need to take permission before you delete their numbers. Say, hey, in this country, I will make it, whether they like it or not. Your next detail will be the next issue. Those are the snake qualities. They are always, the snake people, they always want to outsmart people. They always want to outsmart God. They play to know even more than God. Church, the solution to your snake and snake-like souls all around you is the word of God. Word of God. Stand firm on the word of God. Know your word. Christ faced his own temptation. In the book of Matthew chapter 4 verse 4. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceed out of the mouth of God. If Christ could defeat his own snake by the word of God, he has given you the weapon. Every Christian must not do without the word of God. Read it. Meditate on it day and night. That is your weapon against snake world. So, brethren, what do I need to do in my Garden of Eden? Quickly, because of our time. What do I need to do in my Garden of Eden? God has given you a job, one important job to do. Every man has jobs. Every position have descriptions. Every job have job descriptions. God has given you a position. That position comes with responsibility. And that responsibility now brings to you job descriptions. What do I need to do? Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. Are we there? Genesis 2, verse 15. And the Lord God, are we there? Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. Let's read together. And the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it, full stop, and keep it. To dress it and to keep it. This will be clear now. God has put you in charge of your own destiny. To dress it, to keep it. Note this. You are the best person to look after yourself. Forget about Kiara. You are the best person for your own job. You are the one who can look at yourself best. You are responsible and accountable for yourself. To be honest, stop blaming people around. Stop blaming the society. Stop blaming the parents that are dead in the grave. You are the one responsible and accountable for your life. The Bible says God put them in that garden and said to dress it and to do what? Keep it. Jesus said it. Nobody, no one took my life. I laid it down by myself. It means God has given every Christian that authority, that power to say, I am not dying. I am not doing what the evil one wants me to do. If you surrender yourself, that is when the evil one can conquer you. Until you leave yourself. Until you, by your own hand, say, this is my life. Handle it the way you like. And that will happen when you forsake Christ. Let's be blunt. The success or the failure of your destiny is in your own hand. That is what I'm saying. If you want to succeed in your Garden of Eden, it's in your hand. If you want to make it in other side, it's in your own hand. You'll be saying, oh, this child, don't kill me. Don't kill me. You know this country? The parent will cry before the child cries. Don't kill me, oh. And one day you just say, hey, don't kill yourself. If you like kill yourself, I will leave. Because you've tried. So your success, your fruitfulness, your ability to make it is in you, is inbuilt. Activate it. You are the only one who can succeed, who can make yourself succeed. You are the only one who can make yourself happy. Stop looking up to people to make you happy. I've said it many times. Stop looking at that husband who will never say thank you. Say thank you to yourself. Stop looking at that wife who will never say, oh, Eshewana. Say, Moshewana to myself. Appreciate yourself when there's no one to appreciate you. God has given you that power. Dress your own garden. Keep your own garden. You have that power. I said about Christ. Christ said, nobody took my life. I laid it down myself. You are the one who can decide what the enemy can do to you. To be honest, know it from today. You are the one who can decide it. The enemy cannot decide your tomorrow. You are the one who can decide it through Christ in you. Say to somebody, be disciplined. Discipline is the solution. God has given you that power. He has given you that authority. He has given you that confidence. He has given you that backup. And he has given you that work to do. Dress your garden. Keep your garden. Your own responsibility. Until a man is disciplined, they cannot be a good disciple of Christ. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. We are rounding down now. For God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power, and of love, and of a sound mind. 2 Timothy, verse 1, 7. Some English, some Bible verses or version will say of discipline, of a sound mind. Brethren, discipline your body. First Corinthians chapter 9 verse 27 says something. First Corinthians chapter 9 verse 27. But I keep under my body and bring it under subjection, lest that by any means, First Corinthians chapter 9 verse 27, lest by any means which I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. If you don't discipline your body, your garden will struggle to succeed. The body will always ask for everything. The body will always request things that are ungodly. Learn to be disciplined. Discipline this body. Discipline your mouth, food, and words. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29. Ephesians 4, 29. Let no corruption communication proceed out of your mouth, but which is good to the use of edifying. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29. We are looking at things to do to be able to succeed and survive in your garden. Discipline. It is your job. God has given you that job. Say, dress your garden. Keep it. You are the one in charge of your life. You allow what you allow to happen. And we are looking at that word that will guide you through, and that will be the one you will remember when you go away today. Discipline yourself. Discipline your body. Discipline your mouth. Let no corruption communication. Ephesians 4:29. Many of us do not discipline our mouth. No corruption communication, words of pride, word of dishonesty, words of gossip. And you know this country, sorry to say this, is like culture. You shut the door, they discuss you before you come back. And they laugh when you come back. You don't need to join that, to be honest with you. Be yourself. What you do not, you cannot say before people, don't say behind them. It's a sin. The same people you discuss behind them, they will gather to discuss you too behind you. The Bible said, let no corruption communication, words of anger, words of envy, swearing words. Discipline yourself. Proverbs 21:23 says, whoever keepeth his mouth, keep his own tongue. Whoever keeps his mouth and his tongue, keep his soul from troubles. Brethren, dedicate your mouth unto the control of God. As Psalm 19:14 says, let the word of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to your sight. Brethren, discipline your desires as well. These are the things you need to maintain. These are the things you need to do in your own garden of Eden to be able to make it. Discipline your desires. Lucifer's desire makes him to be chased out of glorious heavenly places. In Isaiah chapter 14, from verse 12 to 14. What you desire, let it be godly. Let your desires be godly directed and dictated. James chapter 1, verse 14. James chapter 1, verse 14. But every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Discipline your children too. Say to somebody, discipline your children.
Discipline your children.
Remember Prophet Eli. His children corrupted his own Garden of Eden. His own Garden of Eden at that point in time was his ministry. The children corrupted it. In fact, it was the news of the death of those children that caused his sudden traumatic death. The Bible says Eli was old of age and he was fat. Put away the fat. And when he had the news that the box of covenant, the ark of covenant has been taken and his children are dead, he went into coma straight away and he died. Same spot. Don't be carried away by the beauty, the blessings of the Garden of Eden you witness around you. Discipline them when it matters. Discipline is not about punching. It's not about getting a boxing glove, say, get your own, I get my own. No. It's all about sit them down, communicate, reach an agreement, set an example, share your experience, go down to their level. There are times the children like it. When you go down to their level to discuss certain things, you are not going to be talking to somebody like this all the time and you expect them to not feel being enslaved. There are times you go down, there are this AI, and say, look, listen, this is what I'm saying. I was once like you. I had it. I lost it. I don't want you to lose it. I never had this opportunity you are having today. Use it very well. Besides, this is what the Bible says about it. Open the Bible. But beloved, you don't even know the Bible verses yourself. Don't be like that woman who always say, hey, and the Lord said, and the children say, mommy, you've always said the Lord said that. What has the Lord said? And everything is, the Lord says it is written. Mommy, what is that that is written? When are you going to say it? It is written. Hey, it is written. Be yourself. It is what you know that people know you by. Know your Bible. Know your words. When you open it, after sharing your life experience, then open the Bible. Discuss it. Say, listen, it happened in the Bible. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And discipline your senses as well. Your senses of hearing, what you hear outside. Your senses of sight, what you watch. Many of our young ones these days, they are into all things that they shouldn't be watching. Youth, and it affects you. What you watch determines your actions. And that's why you have to be disciplined what you watch. There are some sites that will discourage you, that will delay you, that can distract you of where you are going. Don't go to those sites. Brethren, to be honest, they're not godly. Discipline your sight. Discipline your taste. Discipline your smell. Somebody's smell. Somebody say taste. It's very important as well. Not all the time, mommy, we need to eat outside. There are times mommy will say, no, we are cooking at home. Take it with love. Mommy is training you to be the best in the house when the time comes. Discipline. Life is the best. Your garden will flourish when you are able to discipline yourself. Those senses, what you hear, discipline it. There are some news you don't need to hear. There are some phone calls you don't pick because you know what will come out of it is not going to be glorified to God, mommy. There are some people that are just going to call you to give you news that will spoil your day. I saw your husband again at Waterloo. I said, what? He's in UK. He's meant to be anywhere he likes. But you said he has gone to work. Yes, he has another branch at Waterloo. Just keep that conversation short. Don't let anybody spoil your marriage. Hey, I can't take it. Is that how your husband do? You better take it. Don't spoil that garden. Be patient. Remember the snake. Like attitude. They are not impatient. They are not patient. They are always impatient. Be patient. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Brethren, the last word. Your garden of Eden is a gate to eternal garden. I want you to know this. Manage your garden of Eden very well. It leads to somewhere else. And that is the eternal life. We have seen people who has not managed their garden of Eden. This is very vital. Note it. Many people have not managed their garden of Eden very well. And that has actually sent them to hellfire. I must be frank with you. Some people, they get carried away by the blessing, the wealth, the pleasantries, the enjoy at their garden of Eden. And that has been the vehicle that has taken them to hell. Don't let that happen to you. Brethren, please, I am begging. Use your garden of Eden to glorify God, to lift God higher. God bless you. We shall continue next week. Hallelujah. Our Lord is good.
All the time.
At this point in time,